And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a mighty rushing wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Welcome to Sounds of Revival, a program and teaching ministry calling for the church to hear and respond to the sounds of revival, which are calling us back to our first love and back to our place of holiness and dominion in the earth. Sounds of Revival is brought to you by Greater Love International Church and Revival Center, located here in the city of Indianapolis at 6433 East Washington Street, where the pastor and founder is Bishop Perry E. Jackson. And now, Sounds of Revival.
Bless you today and welcome to our program, Sounds of Revival, brought to you by Greater Love International Church and Revival Center. Well, God is still good and God is still in the saving business. Thank God, even the title of our program entitled Sounds of Revival, God is still calling for His people to come back to Him, to be revived and to rise from the dead, spiritually dead. And so we all need, at one time in our life, we need reviving, Christians. And so we thank God that He does offer repentance to all of us. Just before going into our message for today, we're going to minister in song. And the song will be, He Looked Beyond My Faults and Saw My Needs. We'll minister that song, and then we'll be right back to minister the Word of God to you. But isn't it wonderful to know that God still saves and keeps and heals? God bless.
Amazing grace shall ever be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I'll never know just why He came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults and saw my needs. Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I'll never know just why He came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults and saw my needs. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary, to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous this grace that caught my fallen soul. He looked beyond my faults and saw my need. I shall forever lift mine eyes to Calvary, to view the cross where Jesus died for me. How marvelous the grace that caught my fallen soul. He looked beyond my faults and saw my need. Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. It was God's grace that bought my liberty. I'll never, never, never know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults. He looked beyond my faults. He looked beyond my faults and saw my need.
Bless you, God. God is good. Amen. And isn't it wonderful? Again, he looked beyond our faults and saw our needs. Because if God looked at us just as we were and had not had mercy on us, none of us would be saved. Lamentations, Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 23 said this, that it is of the Lord's mercy that we're not consumed, because his compassions fail not, they are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. Thank God for his mercy. The Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 5, verse number 6, for when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. We didn't have strength in our own, but God died for us through his Son. Now we have strength. Paul said, of course, in the book of Philippians chapter 4, verse number 19, Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So praise God for strength. Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yea, I will help you. I will uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. So God does give us strength, and he bears us up. Amen. He carries us. When we can't handle life's problems, tests by ourselves, he just carries us. Just like God sent a man to help Jesus when he was bearing his cross up Golgotha's hill. And Jesus fell beneath the load, but he sent someone there to help him carry that cross. Glory to God. To carry the cross for him. So God still does the same thing to us today. Again, the song says, amazing grace shall for always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. Glory to God. Grace bought our liberty. And he looked beyond our faults and saw our needs. Amen. And guess what? We're not perfect yet, so he still needs to look past some stuff in us that's covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, so when, for example, when saints do fall and mess up, then there is a way for them to get back to God. There is a way for them to get back in right standing with God. And that word is called repent. And when we repent, then we can get back to our place of righteousness, our place of love, our place of right standing in God. But first we have to repent. And that's an interesting statement there, an interesting word, that we'll repent. Because now we're talking about revival and how we as God's people need to be revived. But sometimes people miss it because they think that they can be revived without repentance. And repentance is something that is really, you don't do that in 2 seconds. But you have to labor before God sometimes. Labor before him and ask God to show you areas in your life where you missed it, areas in your life where you are basically just even in sin. So when we talk about revival is really needed. Of course, the name of our program is Sounds of Revival. And when the Holy Spirit told me to go on TV, and the next thing I said, okay, God, what is the name of the program going to be? And he said, the name of the program will be Sounds of Revival. And then he began to tell me about the need for his people to repent. Just like in the book of Revelations, Jesus talked to the 7 churches of Asia, and each message that he gave to them was a revival message, telling them that they need to revive and come back to him because their life in him. Some, Revelation 3, he said, thou hast a name that thou livest and are dead. And then another church, he said, you left your first love. Another church said that your robes are filthy. They were once white. So he corrected the churches and said, You need reviving because you're in a place where you're not pleasing to me. Revive me and get back to strength and get back to normal. Get back to your place of God where you need to be. So God is still, after we are born again, and he, as it were, catches our fallen soul, we were going to hell, but he caught us, and picked us up, turned us around. Psalm 40, verse 1, how that he picked us up out of a horrible pit. That's wonderful. But now we have to stay out of that pit and ask God to show us how to stay out of that pit. And if we do fall, the Bible did say in the book of Psalm 37, verse number 23 and 24, it said this, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord will uphold him with his hand. So the good man, again, Psalm 37, 23 and 24, talks about a good man, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, but yet he falls. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. What does that mean? If you fall into a state of being in sin or a state of not pleasing God, then you need revived. You need your relationship revived with God that you may come back into a place of right standing with him. You do not just have a right standing with God just because you got born again so many years ago. No, you have to have maintenance more or less done on your walk with God. You have to keep it maintained. The Bible says in the book of Jude, chapter 1, keep yourself in the love of God. Then Jesus said in the book of Revelation, chapter 3, verse number 11, he said, behold, I come quickly, hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take your crown. Now, I've given you a crown, but listen, again, Revelation 3, 11. Jesus said, behold, I come quickly, hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take your crown. You have a crown waiting for you, but you have to hold on to it. Again, the Bible said, Galatians chapter 5, verse number 1, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherein Christ hath made you free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Christians, you have been warned. You have been made free. You've been liberated in Christ. Christ bought you liberty. Let me quote Galatians 5 and 1 again. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherein Christ has made you free. And then the second part says, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Satan desires to take you back into bondage. John chapter 10, verse 10. Jesus said, the thief or the devil cometh not before to steal, kill, and destroy. But I am come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. He said, he warns you what the devil will do. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He can steal from you. He can kill you. Amen. Naturally and spiritually. I got a Bible for that. Again, Revelation 3, he told the people, the church of Sardis, you have a name that you live, but you're dead. Hallelujah. You're dead. You're not alive anymore. So Satan can steal, kill, and destroy in churches. He can kill church people. How does he do that? Because we are not watching. That's why Jesus said, watch and pray. Glory to God. That's why the Bible said, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse number 8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. What does that word be sober? That means don't play. Be sober, be vigilant. That means vigilant talks about when you're being at night, you wake up and you are alert. Amen. Be vigilant. Amen. You're watching and you're looking and you're protecting. So, Christians, God wants you to understand that you have an assignment. After he saves you, then you have an assignment upon your life to stay revived and to keep your place, keep yourself in a place that you are alive in God. Now, the last program we talked about what revival is and what revival is not. And one thing the Bible said the revival is not, the revival is not saving the lost only. The revival is first saving the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So if you look into Matthew chapter 10, verse 5 through 7, Jesus said, I'm come that I might save the lost sheep of the house of Israel. The lost sheep, you're his own people. Then he gets to the sinner man. But too many times we we are so interested in other folk being saved. You should be interested in other people being saved, but remember again, make sure you are revived. If you want the sinner to be revived, then you be revived. Remember, Paul said this, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 26 and 27, he said this, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 26, 27, the Apostle Paul speaking, he said this, I keep under my body and bring into subjection, lest by any means, after I have preached the gospel to others, and I myself should be cast away. Did you get that? Paul said, so I cannot be so interested in other folk getting saved that I don't keep an eye on my own salvation. First, I'm going to quote that again. Get your Bible, write that down, write that scripture down, read it for yourself. Paul said, 1 Corinthians 9, 26, 27, I keep under my body, bring into subjection, lest by any means, after I have preached the gospel to others, I myself should be cast away. I'm a child of God, but I want to stay in good graces with God. What does the word cast away mean? Jesus followed the same line of thought that Paul did when he said in the book of Revelation, in the book of Matthew, chapter 7, verse 22, 23, and 24, he said this, many shall come to me in that day saying, have we not preached in your name? Have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out devils in your name? And the Lord said, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Now listen, these were preachers. See, this correlates with 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 26, 27, where Paul said, I don't want to preach to others and then myself be a castaway. And then Jesus warned us of the same thing, Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, 22, 23, and 24. He said this, that many will come to me in that day saying, now these are preachers, these are saved folk, Lord, have we not preached in your name? Have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out devils in your name, done miracles in your name? And he will say, you know what he's going to say? I never knew you. Depart from me. Why? Because their life was not what it should be. They had put revival. They were so interested in preaching to other people, so interested in prophesying to other people, so interested in casting the devils out of other people, they forgot there was a devil in them that needed to be cast out. Amen. Glory to God. Just because you cast some devil out of other folk, that don't mean you don't have some devil you got to be dealing with also. Amen. Hallelujah. And just because you preach to other people about how they need to be clean, that doesn't mean your life is clean just because you're preaching about somebody else have their life cleaned up. Amen. Because the Bible said that the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. Throughout the Bible, men have been preachers, they have been prophets, and they have got other folks saved. But yet they were damned and went to hell themselves because they didn't focus on their own salvation first. So let's remember, you're not being selfish when you think about, I want to be saved first, and then I think about the sinners. Amen. You don't put other people's salvation before your salvation. You don't get so lost up in preaching and helping other folks that you forget that you need some help yourself. Glory to God. I could give many other scriptures where men of God have been commissioned to do great things for God. They've done great things for God, but yet they didn't keep their eye on Jesus. They didn't maintain their relationship with him. Amen. And other people got saved through their ministry, but they themselves, hallelujah, were had sin in their life. They themselves, the same thing that they were telling other folk to do, they were doing themselves behind closed doors. Amen. The same sin that they told other people, they tell us that sin's going to send you to hell, then they're doing behind closed doors. And that same sin that will send the sinner to hell, that same sin that will put an unsaved saint in hell, then that same sin will put the pastor in hell also. Don't think that just because you preach the word that you are above the word. Amen. Don't think just because God uses you, then that makes you that you are right. Amen. Again, the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. And so the church can get off out of balance, and you can lose purpose. Glory to God. And you can be doing something that you shouldn't be doing. In other words, thinking that just because other people are getting saved, because I helped somebody else get saved, then I'm okay. No, it doesn't work like that. Someone else can be saved by your testimony, but because you didn't obey the same thing you're telling them to do, then you're going to be in a bad position with God. God is not going to be smiling on you. If there's sin in your life, don't expect God to be smiling on you. God does not smile at sin. He frowns on sin. I don't care who the sin is in. If the sin is in the bishop, I guess people say, well, since I'm a bishop, then when God sees sin in my life, he'll smile instead of frown. No, the Bible says the wages of sin is death. For preachers, just like it is for anyone else, glory to God. For the Pope, you might, well the Pope, then no matter what the Pope does, then he's okay. Don't you fool yourself. Is the Pope God? Is the Pope Jesus? Then he has to pay for his sin as well. Don't put any man on a pedestal, glory to God. To the extent that you think if there's sin in his life, then God will overlook it. Amen. And don't put yourself on a pedestal. If you think that because you're doing so many good works, then that you're all right with God. No, you may be doing good works. Paul said, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, if I give all my goods to feed the poor, if I give my body to be burned, if I can prophesy and speak and move mountains, have mountains move in faith, but if I don't have the love of God in my heart, what is that love? If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. If there's sin in my life, if I'm not obeying God, then I can move mountains, but I'm not right with God. I can give all my goods to the poor. I can be very sensitive to the needs of poor folk. I may have a ministry to poor folk. Just because you got a ministry to poor folk, that don't mean you're saved. You're not saved by works. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 8, the Bible says, by grace are you saved through faith. Not that of yourself. It is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Don't let Satan deceive you into thinking that because you're doing good works, that you're doing a lot of good things. No. The Bible said, mark the perfect man and behold the upright, for the end of that man is peace. That's Psalm 37, verse 37. The perfect man, we're striving to a perfection. We want zero sin in our life. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, the Bible said this, Christ also loved the church, gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Did you get that? Amen. Well, if that's the church he's looking for, he's not coming back looking for a church that has spots, wrinkles, blemishes. My goodness, your white robe used to be white. It's all messed up. Glory to God. Thanks to Jesus, it got wine and beer stains all over it. Glory to God, stained. Thank you, Jesus, with smoke, your robe smelling like smoke, like marijuana. And, oh, yes, you got Christians like that on drugs. Christians doing everything they're big enough to do. Christians doing everything they're not big enough to do, still walking in church saying, I'm holy. No, the devil told you were holy. God didn't tell you were holy. You know why? Because God don't tell lies. Amen. And if you're not living right, if sin is in your life, God's not going to lie for you and tell you you're holy. Are you serious? God's not a liar. Hallelujah. No, the devil's a liar, and you're the liar. Amen. But that's all right. You can stop lying. You can repent. Amen. And take a good look at yourself and say, God, I'm sorry. I lied to myself, and I lied to you, and I want to get it right. I want to start telling the truth. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs, chapter 23, verse 23, buy the truth and sell it not. Amen. Don't let that lying devil, the Bible says Satan is the father of lies. He lies real good. As a matter of fact, the Bible said in the book of Matthew, chapter 24, verse number 12, he said that Satan is such a good liar that if it were possible, he would deceive the very elect of God. That's Matthew, chapter 24, verse number 12. That's a pretty big lie. If it were possible, Satan would deceive the very elect of God. Oh, he's a good liar. Amen. And he lied to Eve. Amen. And Eve bought the lie. And so you are no better than Eve. Be careful. You don't buy the lie of the devil. Eve said, told the devil, God said, we can't eat this fruit. And the devil said, hath God said? God didn't say that. Yes, he did. Amen. She found out that he did say it. And the same thing could happen to you and I. You could be doing something that you know is wrong. But the devil will convince you, had God said, that's not really wrong. Don't buy the lie of the devil. No, buy the truth and sell it not. So we're still talking about how saints need revived. We're talking about saints, you need help more than you think you do. We all need help. We need help. The Psalm 121, verse 1, the writer said, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hill, for what comes my help? My help comes from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. We need help. Again, the book of Hebrews chapter 4, verse number 16. Come boldly, therefore, unto the throne of grace, that ye may obtain mercy and find grace and help in the time of need. We need to stay on our faith before God, that he can show us ourselves, not just show us the sinner, but show us ourselves. Show us where we need to be saved. Amen. Christians, because there are unsaved Christians. Amen. They don't have a clue that they're lost. Amen. They're just that deceived. Amen. Preaching, saying in the choir, and they think if they die tonight, they will go to heaven. But they don't know. They're going to be surprised when they wake up in hell. Amen. Because they don't face the truth now. Revival called for the saints. Face the truth. Amen. Because it's truth or consequence. Amen. So if you think in terms of what revival really means, it means you seeing the truth about yourself, seeing the truth about ourselves, then seeing the truth about the sinner, seeing the truth that we make sure we are not cast away, as Paul said. Amen. Make sure we're still saved. Amen. That's what revival will help you to do. Time is up. We'll talk to you next time. And God bless you, and God loves you, and so do I. God bless you, and we want to make you an offer today. The Bible says in the book of John chapter 14, verse 26, it says this, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father shall send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring unto your remembrance all things whatsoever I said unto you. So if you desire to hear this program again and other programs that we've done, we have a code right there on your screen, and you can just Google this code into your computer, and Google it in on your cell phone, and you will be able to hear the messages again. So that code, of course, is HTTP, and then it has a colon there, 2/ forward and so forth, and that will actually pop up our program again for you, and you can listen to it again, because again, sometimes if you listen to a message twice, you can receive something that you did not even receive the first time. So God bless you, and avail yourself to that particular benefit we're offering you right now. God bless.
Sounds of Revival was brought to you by Perry Jackson Ministries and Greater Love International Church and Revival Center. Worship Sunday at 8 a.m. and 10:30 a.m., Tuesday Bible class at 7:30 p.m., and Saturday morning Bible class and communion at 8 a.m. Prayer precedes all services. For directions or to receive your free bi-monthly newsletter, call 317-796-0938 or email jackson-perry@att.net. To request today's program or sermon on CD, please send an offering of any amount to Perry Jackson Ministries, P.O. Box 26891, Indianapolis, Indiana 46226. Ask for the offer number on the screen.